solid-state batteries could address some of the biggest issues facing energy storage and EVs, like safety, charge capacity, and longevity. But the biggest problem they face is cost. You can probably see why my interest was piqued when I heard about a new electrode manufacturing technique that apparently uses less energy, less materials, and less factory floor space, all of which means more savings. Plus, researchers have found a new cathode material that works just as well as lithium iron phosphate, but costs only 1 or 2% of its price, potentially knocking 50 to 60% off the cost of a finished battery. That's right, 50 to 60% off the entire battery's price. So how are these massive savings even possible? And could these innovations realistically dethrone current manufacturing methods and battery materials? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Rocket Money. You may have noticed that battery prices are already falling. China's two largest battery suppliers, CATL and BYD, are in a full-blown price war after ramping up production in 2022, right before EV sales unexpectedly fell in 2023. In early 2024, CATL announced plans to push prices 50% lower to undercut its competitor. Although Goldman Sachs expects a 50% price drop isn't likely until 2026. And if that price drop does happen, Goldman Sachs predicts EVs may finally reach price parity with traditional internal combustion engine cars. But this isn't just about EVs. These dropping prices will impact everything, including home batteries, grid-scale energy storage systems, and eventually the phone that you're probably watching this video on. The ultimate goal is to make these technologies accessible to everyone. And to get there, manufacturing and material costs are going to have to drop even further. So let's cover a couple of the things that will get us there. First is a new manufacturing technique entering production now that will lower one of the most costly parts of a battery, their electrodes. The California-based battery technology firm Saku is beginning to license Cavian, the world's first platform for 3D printing battery electrodes. Both the cathode that donates ions during charging and the anode that accepts them will be 3D printed on the Cavian platform. Electrodes are traditionally manufactured in a wet process. Cathode or anode materials are mixed with toxic solvents like NMP to create a slurry. This is coated onto metal foils like copper for the anode and aluminum for the cathode, and then dried in an oven to evaporate the solvent. This means energy is used to heat the ovens and to capture and recycle that toxic solvent. Now, all of this requires equipment with huge factory footprints. We're talking about 80 meter or about 262 feet long equipment that can be several stories high. Saku's Cavian platform only occupies a small footprint in comparison, at just 15 to 20 meters or about 49 to 65 feet long. They can effectively manufacture electrodes with their dry process that doesn't use solvents or an oven. Dry electrode powder is 3D printed onto foils at a desired thickness, conditioned, and then inspected. If a batch of electrode fails the quality check, it's straightforward to recover that expensive electrode material and then try again, unlike with a wet manufacturing process. These material and space efficiencies add up. According to Saku, its dry printing platform requires less capital investment at startup, uses 30% less factory floor space, and 25% less labor. The company claims it eliminates those toxic solvents, wastes less water, and uses a third less energy in comparison to wet electrode manufacturing. It likely also saves on the expended solvent disposal cost too. That's a lot of savings to be passed on to the consumer, especially if those battery price wars continue. So, fingers crossed. You're probably wondering though, what kind of batteries are we talking about? Nickel, cobalt, lithium? And the answer is yes. Throw aluminum and sodium onto that list too. Saku says its dry printing can be adapted to a lot of different cathode and anode materials, whether they'll be used with a liquid or solid electrolyte. What I find most interesting is that the dry printing technology could open up even more options. Denser electrodes, multi-layered electrodes, and electrodes that are made from materials that weren't compatible with the wet process. So they really haven't been explored that much yet. By eliminating the slurry and 3D printing the electrode, these batteries can easily take on any shape. This dry printing method allows for custom designs that fit seamlessly into products like an e-bike frame, maximizing battery size without wasting space, even in unusual shapes. Now, instead of building a phone around a battery pack, a battery could be built around the other components in the phone, giving small electronics the most oomph possible in a tiny package. 3D printing also allows for more geometric flexibility in designs, which allows for more electrode surface area. With such a novel technique, more research can be conducted to optimize electrode shape. And knowing all of that, it's unsurprising that Saku's Cavian platform has been named to Time's list of the best inventions of 2024. But invention is only the first step. We're looking for technologies that are rollout ready. And that's why Saku is partnering with two established battery makers to take the Cavian platform into the industrial space with hopes for more partnerships and licenses in the future. SK On, the world's fifth largest battery manufacturer with headquarters in South Korea and additional production facilities in the US, is beginning a joint development project with Saku to perfect their dry printing technology for industrial scale operations. Saku is also partnering with Quebec-based Electrion as it scales up the production of its aluminum ion-based batteries for incorporation into grid systems, showing just how versatile the Cavium platform is for a variety of electrode materials. And Saku isn't the only company launching dry electrode manufacturing either. Tesla is beginning to incorporate dry-coated electrodes into its latest and greatest battery, the 4680. And AM Batteries just shipped its first rolls of nickel-manganese-cobalt electrodes with its own dry-coating method to a major battery cell provider for performance validation. After fine-tuning the assembly line, it's time to nickel and dime, and maybe even penny those material costs, because there are some insane savings at play here. And speaking of saving money, I got thrown for a loop when I recently discovered that I was being charged for a video streaming service that I hadn't used in months. Have you ever had something like that happen? Well, today's sponsor, Rocket Money, can help you with that. Rocket Money is the personal finance app that helps you cancel subscriptions, lower bills, and manage your money better. After I signed up for Rocket Money, the app highlighted that long-forgotten subscription of mine, told me when it was set to renew again, and offered to help me cancel it right within the app with just a few taps. I didn't even have to worry about dealing with customer service. Rocket Money has helped save customers up to $740 a year when using all of the app's premium features, with over $500 million in canceled subscriptions. They can even help you lower your bills just by uploading a photo of your bill, like your cell phone bill, and tapping a few buttons. Rocket Money will negotiate your bills for you to get the best rate. I've also been using the app to set myself a new budget to help keep spending in check. It's automatically monitoring my spending, putting those expenses into categories, and letting me know when I've exceeded my limits. It's fantastic. Take control of your finances today. Go to rocketmoney.com/undecided to get started for free. Thanks to Rocket Money and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to those material costs. Right now, electrodes are applied onto cheap aluminum and expensive copper foils, which act as current collectors, allowing electricity to flow in and out of the battery. But copper is so pricey that even pennies had to downsize. Since the 1980s, they've been made with a thin copper coating over zinc. Let's face it, when pennies are pinching pennies, you know it's time to rethink copper in batteries. Although it's still in the experimental phase and far from commercial deployment, Saku is exploring a couple of ways to drop the expense and the weight from current collectors. The company is developing battery cells without current collecting copper and aluminum foils on the outside, or even tabs from the negative and positive terminals. Instead, individual cells can be stacked up to create high-voltage batteries that only have metal foils on their outermost edges. This reduces battery materials, weight, and cost even more. Instead of metal foils, Saku is pivoting towards composite current collectors, which are typically polymers engineered with conductive additives that boost their conductivity while reducing overall weight. Switching from metals to cheap polymer composites could potentially drop the cost of current collectors by 75%. And assuming about 10% of the price of a battery is current collectors, that's a whopping 7.5% potential price drop for future batteries. Polymer-based current collectors also offer peace of mind for anyone haunted by viral videos of lithium battery fires. They can be fire retardant, helping to suppress thermal runaway and reduce ignition risk. With advancements in battery cost, weight, and safety, it's no surprise that composite current collectors are a growing focus of innovation. At the U.S. Department of Energy's Oak Ridge National Laboratory, researchers recently unveiled a metal-free current collector for graphite anodes. Crafted from carbon fibers and nanotubes embedded in a polymer matrix, their composite current collector had better charge transfer and faster charging speeds than traditional copper foil. The race is on to develop polymer-based current collectors optimized for each battery type. To succeed, they'll need to match at least the performance of copper foil and demonstrate durability across thousands of charge and discharge cycles. And the urgency couldn't be greater. The International Energy Agency warns that if nations are on track to meet their climate targets, global copper production will only satisfy about 70% of the projected demand by 2035. Even more concerning, global lithium mining is projected to meet only about 50% of demand by 2035. The rock-bottom prices we enjoy for lithium batteries today could rebound sharply within the next decade unless we develop alternative cathode materials that match lithium energy's density. But there's also progress happening right now to diversify the lithium supply chain and make it more affordable too, but that's a separate video. I call out the cathode because it's the MVP of battery performance. It impacts capacity, energy density, and lifespan, while also tipping the scales as the heaviest component. That's why the R&D is so heavy on cathodes in comparison to the anode or electrolyte. Hailong Chen and his research team at the Georgia Institute of Technology, also known as Georgia Tech, in Atlanta, are unleashing the potential of a cathode material you've probably never heard of, iron trichloride. And chlorides haven't previously been viable as cathode materials because they dissolve in the liquid electrolytes used in traditional lithium-ion batteries. But with solid-state technologies on the horizon, researchers revisited this cheap material with priceless results. Small-scale iron trichloride batteries built in Chen's laboratory outperformed the cheapest commercially available lithium cathode material, lithium iron phosphate. Despite a slightly lower specific capacity at 159 milliamp-hours per gram compared to lithium iron phosphate's 170, the iron trichloride cathode delivered a high voltage of 3.65 volts versus 3.4 volts. And this combination resulted in a superior energy density of 558 watt-hours per kilogram, exceeding the typical range of lithium iron phosphate batteries, which falls between 420 and 550 watt-hours per kilogram. Now the real question is, does this cathode chemistry stand the test of time? Their iron trichloride battery retained 83% of its initial capacity after 1,000 cycles, with an impressive efficiency of 99.95%. That's comparable to many commercial lithium iron batteries using cobalt and manganese, but it falls short of the 2,000 plus cycles above 80% capacity that you typically see in a lithium iron phosphate battery. Still, for an early stage design, it's an impressive result. With further development and optimization, iron trichloride battery longevity may well match that of lithium iron phosphate. And if it does, it'll deliver better long-term performance at a lower price point. So how do they slash the costs? Well, unlike cobalt and nickel, which are difficult and expensive to extract, iron and chloride are among the most abundantly available elements on Earth. Iron is mined in vast quantities for steel production or recycled from scrap steel, while chloride is easily extracted from brines and other salt sources. Together, they're sustainable, plentiful, and incredibly cheap. It's ideal ingredients for driving down battery costs. In fact, an iron trichloride cathode is just 1% the cost of a lithium cobalt oxide cathode and 2% of the cost of a lithium iron phosphate cathode. Even with the added cost of the lithium anode required by the iron trichloride cathode, Chen's team estimates that the total cost of the battery system could drop from the current $120 to $150 per kilowatt hour for a lithium iron battery cell to just $50 to $80 per kilowatt hour. If that's true once this leaves the lab, it would represent a savings of about 50 to 60%. And those are the kinds of price drops that might bring EVs and home energy storage within the reach of most people. Those are the kinds of cost cuts that could speed up the transition away from internal combustion engines and towards cleaner, more sustainable electric motors. However, we may be waiting a while longer. These technologies, which eliminate lithium from the cathode and ditch copper from the current collectors, are still stuck in R&D and likely 5 or more years away from commercialization. With the rollout of iron trichloride cathodes hinging on solid-state technologies, the market debut could end up being solid late. As dry electrode manufacture enters its commercial phase, we'll hopefully see consistent price drops for lithium-ion batteries, even if the price war starts to cool. Because, well, that's the thing about game-changing innovation. It's not usually the flashy breakthroughs that make it happen. Instead, it's the practical advances like smarter materials, streamlined designs, and more efficient manufacturing. By focusing on abundant resources and cutting energy inputs, these technologies don't just slash costs, but pay off their carbon debt faster too. In the end, it's a win for your wallet and the environment. Now that's a greener future we can all plug into. But what do you think? Do you think these battery price wars and cost savings are gonna hit rock bottom like they say? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still To Be Determined. We'll keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support and helping to keep the channel going. Keep your mind open, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.